I am not as aware of Derek's background as Susan Amos is, and she's really credited with having our, with getting the speaker here tonight. She started presenting this idea how many years ago? No, how many months ago?
It was in the spring.
It was. Yeah, it was. So as soon as we started bringing back the lecture series, she pulled me aside and said, "We really got to get Derek Orr in here to talk about the Octagon House." So I'm glad we're able to do this. And but I'm going to let Susan introduce our speaker tonight. Was that yours or mine?
I think that's Derek.
That's good.
Did you want a water?
No, I've got one.
Okay, thank you.
It's my husband that does the microphone, not me, so bear with me. For those of you who do not know me, I am Susan Thomas Amos. Remember that middle part that's coming. And I'd also like to give a nod to the namesake of our Kegley series. It's George Kegley and his wife, Louise, and I wish his son was here. used to live at Mountain View, as we know here in Roanoke, it's a beautiful home. And Derek is here to talk about Mountain View that's in Marion, so there is another view. But I thought for the Kegley series, Mrs. Kegley there. The thing I am getting too much credit for is that I know Derek more. We're getting to know each other. The first thing I knew about him a few years ago was he was the guy that outbid my brother on my great-great-grandfather's home. So it went to Derek, and I'm so glad it did. Derek has a great vision of this house. He's got a great purpose for this house, which I think is amazing. And also, it needs a lot of work. So, but anyway, I wanted to bring that out too. Derek does live in Marion with his beautiful family. He studied architecture at University of Tennessee. He also then went on to study psychology. Right. Okay, I'm looking at Zach because you need to talk to Zach about that. At Emory and Henry, back to Marion. And then he finished with his master's at Radford.
Radford?
Yes. Got my kids here. So, and he's currently working as a, and this is where Stephen can help me more, therapeutic specialist, but he's at Highlands Community Services. He can explain that more to you, otherwise I will definitely botch it up. But in addition to all of that, he is the president, as you pointed out, of the Octagon House Foundation, which has become a true, true endeavor. And I did want to add a side note, he doesn't know I'm doing this, but I've fallen in love with his mother. Not only is the Octagon House my focus, but also everything that Abijah Thomas, who built this house, he also built to Holster Mills. That's not part of the lecture tonight, otherwise we'd be here till midnight or so. But Derek's mom grew up there in the Holster Mills. So she's got more of a story too. So I'm digging and digging and putting all these stories together. It's very fascinating. Now, the reason that I confused Stephen so much is I said, the lecture has to be in November. And he said, why? I said, it involves what we were taught, pilgrims. And he said, what's that got to do with the Octagon House? Well, we Thomases, we kind of stretch things. And it says so in the Octagon House book that we'll be passing around in a bit. But the idea of, you know, what does the Octagon House have to do with the Mayflower? Well, it's an interesting story. We are descendants of the Mayflower. Abijah Thomas was 9th generation Mayflower. So that makes me 13th generation. And I have a 14th generation Mayflower. Anybody else Mayflower Society? Okay. Well, we just thought it was fun. So that's where that came. But that's a whole nother lecture because that is very interesting about Stephen Hopkins of the Mayflower. It's a history we are learning a little bit more about than what we knew about pilgrims. So it's very interesting. So now that I've taken a good chunk of time, I'm going to turn this over to Derek Orr, who is amazing in the terms of what he's planning, doing, and achieving with the Octagon House. So thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, Susan, for that wonderful introduction. I think it's interesting, and Susan and I, we've spent the day together, to talked about how 150 years later, that her great-great-grandfather and my great-great-grandfather met in a different city in Boston. That's how one branch of my family came to Southwest Virginia. So it's interesting how history is intertwined in so many different ways. And it's been a pleasure to get to know Susan, her connections to the house through her family. But let me tell you a little bit about how this story started. And like she stated, Stephen Hopkins was an ancestor of their branch of family who came to Jamestown after being shipwrecked in the Bahamas. He was on the second wave of the same Jamestown. Eventually went back to England and came over in the Mayflower. He's the only person to do that. So when we talk about American stories before there was the United States, this family has a lot of lineage into that history and legacy. But yet here in Southwest Virginia, we come to the pinnacle of that family's roots and what they have left us. And if you can't hear me, yell at me. We're good. I'll hear you if you yell. I could talk all night, but I won't, I promise. There is so much to this house and this story, but it comes to saving the Virginia landmark. And most people don't even know that this place existed. It was abandoned for 80 years. Not kept, wanted to be washed away. And then my grandmother, there's another tie to this house. When her and my grandfather were first married, they lived in this house. And she said, like Gone with the Wind, the only movie she ever saw was that he carried her up the staircase. So my family has lots of ties to the home itself. I grew up 2 to 3 miles south of the home, so I was always told about stories of the house. And I guess through my mother and my grandparents, that's why my love of architecture, especially colonial antebellum and the Gilded Age architecture, I love this style of architecture, and it's unusual. So let's start here. You have to think that back in the late 1700s, Southwest Virginia, and I don't mean Roanoke, I mean far Southwest Virginia, almost 2 hours from here, was still an isolated, desolate place if you want to look at it like that. But we had people who wanted to migrate to that area, use the natural resources that were there. The plantation culture that you see in the colonial times and later in Eastern Virginia, a lot of people think that did not work in Southwest Virginia because of the mountains area, that you just wasn't able to make a profit, make a living. So a lot of what you saw was subsistence farmers, small farms. The climate itself was not inductive to large-scale farming, cotton, tobacco. We do have tobacco in the area, we used to, but your growing season was shorter. Socially and economically isolated, the roads at that time before the railroad came through, it would take you weeks, if not months, to travel somewhere because of the absence of roads. You had the Great Wagon Road that was based on the American Indian trails. So you didn't have a lot of ways to get or take produce in and out. So you moved there, you lived there, and that was usually your life was in that area within a few miles of where you started. But again, small-scale farming was the norm for that area in that time. Subsistence farming. But a few people, like Thomas Thomas, which was Abijah Thomas's father, they moved to that area in the late 1700s, and he started purchasing land and receiving land grants. Under Abijah's father, you know, it ran from 400 to maybe 1,000 acres, not a lot. But then you have Abijah, who was a foremost thinker. He was not only an excellent hunter, he was literate, and that was because of his parents. He was engaged in so many operations. He was part of the militia at a young age, a captain at a young age. So there were times that he was the foremost thinker of the area. And we see this later, once he was able, or inherited, the Thomas Home Place, as we call it. But when it comes to architecture, if you look at the pictures, that's a cabin. That's typical for that area at that time, a one-room cabin. A little wealthier, a little more landed, would have something closer to the clapboard or weatherboard type house, 2/2 farmhouse. And then you have, if you can see, it's a darker picture. This is a federal style plantation home. And this home, you'll see in a while, was very important. It is no longer there. That's a picture from last year. But those were the typical plantation homes of the time. Now, the early 1800s, up through, let's say, the war between the states and Civil War time, we saw primary architectural type homes being built. The classic one that everyone thinks is a plantation home is the Greek Revival. Something similar to that. It has a large entablature, columns, that type of architecture. But you also have the Italian, which came later, with the brackets, wide eaves, just a little different. It was kind of off of the ordered society of Greek Revival architecture. Then you have Gothic Revival, which there's not a lot of that left, but that was a new trend coming up from the in that growth period before the Civil War. And that was not only south, there was north as well. So as a westward expansion, you saw more of those types of homes and buildings with that architecture. Then you have the Octagon. Now, a lot of you may know Thomas Jefferson's Poplar Forest at Lynchburg. That was one of the first Octagon houses in America. It didn't become a fad. That was something that came out of Thomas Jefferson's architectural mind. And you all know that he worked and worked and worked and thought and thought and thought. Poplar Forest, which was his retreat in Monticello. So, the Octagon fad really didn't take place until about in the 1840s, and it was started by a man named Orson Fowler from New York. He was a phrenologist, and if you don't know what that is, that's someone who feels the bumps on your head and talks about personality and those type of things. But anyway, he's well known for his design of Octagon houses. He wrote the book, Octagon House, A Home for All. His reasoning for an octagon house was that it was cheaper to build, it was easier to ventilate, easier to heat, and you get more square footage for less money. So at the time, it was looked at as a poor man's mansion, which ultimately it switched. So you can see one of the octagon houses in New York here, one of the most ornate and beautiful octagon houses built in the United States. You have here the three-story octagon house. Then you have a two-story. So they came in all range of sizes, floors, stories. Orson Fowler's was in New York. It was 8 stories tall. Well, they finally demolished it after, and I believe it was 1870s, after a bunch of neighborhood kids had a Halloween party in it. It was so dangerous that they tore it down. He never got rich from his book or his fad. But that was something that he started, and according to what we understand, Abijah Thomas from Marion, who was the business associate with the Douglas family, who owned large tracts of land in what is now the Jefferson National Forest, would travel back and forth to New York and conduct their business and transactions, and he met Orson Fowler in New York, went to his home, came back to Marion and decided that he would like to have an octagon house himself. Again, there's your foremost thinker. He went away from the Greek Revival and the federal types of architecture. He wanted to design this house himself. He took ideas from Orson Fowler's house, but he designed the octagon house himself. And that was unusual. The houses we saw previously, you can imagine seeing those homes and then coming up on the Octagon House, which would have been a amazing. You have to look at what people saw in those times, not what we see now. We have access to everything. But to walk by or to ride by and see this magnificent brick mansion in the shape of the octagon, they must have thought, how odd. And they were amazed. And we do hear stories of how people were just in awe of this house. Why would someone build a round house? And in our area, it's affectionately known as a round house. I was talking to Susan today, that area itself would not be the same without this house. So in 1855, somewhere around that time, he had his slaves, which he was a slave owner, start construction, which took several years to make the brick, cut the timber, dry the timber, and they started and completed in 1858. This picture on the left is the earliest known picture we have of the Octagon House. It was actually a copy sent to us from France, where one of Abijah Thomas's daughters, he and Priscilla Cabinet Scott Thomas, they had 10 children that were born in this house from 1858, even into the Civil War. One of his daughters went to school in France, came home, and then married and moved back to France. Still have family lineage there. They sent us this photograph. It's black and white, it's grainy, it's old, but it shows how it looked then. The picture on the right is from a local folk art artist who gave some color to that picture. You can see how, just your idea of how it looked at that time. Well, let me give you a little background. Before the Civil War, you can call it what you like, Civil War, war between the states, either way it was war. Before that time, Mr. Thomas, again, the foremost thinker and called the foremost industrialist in Southwest Virginia, his plantation system did not rely on the agrarian system. He had an iron furnace, iron foundry. He had a tannery. He had woolen mills. And if you get up, you can look at the picture of the woolen mills that were about 3 miles downriver from the house. That was one of the largest industries in Virginia at the outbreak of the Civil War, right? Marion, so I keep saying down here, but for Virginia to have industry, that was one of the largest, employing 100 and some people at one point during the war. So his woolen mills, his iron foundry, his tannery, made Marion the target because his ironworks provided pig iron, which is semi-reduced iron, to Tredegar Ironworks in Richmond for cannon. His tannery would have provided leather for horses, saddles, those type of things. But the war did not come to Smith County until 1864. They also had the salt works at Saltville and the Virginia-Tennessee Railroad that ran through Smith County. So the Northern Yankee soldiers, when they targeted that area, they destroyed his iron furnace, they destroyed the salt works, they burned the tannery. They did not destroy the woolen mills, and they did not destroy the house, even though they ransacked the house. In the Smith Library, there are letters from Abijah's eldest daughter to back and forth between her and a captain in the Confederate Army. And it really, that story is one of the greatest love stories, if you read the letters, that you will ever hear. He was set in this house on Christmas Eve in 1864 and wrote her a letter after the family had fled. But they didn't burn the house. The war itself, though, did destroy his economic empire. Now, again, that foremost thinker was an agrarian. He didn't raise crops for profits. He was into the industry. What could have been amassed the largest fortune in the state at the time because he had ventured on so many different capital ventures. If the war hadn't happened, Who knows? It's one of those guessing games. But the war did deeply harm the Thomas family. And after the war, there were many lawsuits against Abijah and Priscilla that chipped away at this plantation that at one time we know of documented 10,000 plus acres. He claimed 25, and that's where he wasn't able to pay for it. He'd already been in the process of purchasing it, but wasn't able to pay for it. So before he passed away in 1876, the court's people chipped away at just about everything that they had. So December 1st, 1876, Mr. Thomas died. He had been to town and came home, got sick, pneumonia, and passed away then, which left his wife and his children, remaining children, to watch their rise just crumble. It wasn't bad enough that the war destroyed a lot that they had, but then they lost their home place and been in their family for generations. Ms. Thomas died in 1885, having lost her home and everything that she knew. She died in the house of her daughter. But I do want to, while I have these pictures up, what you saw of the Octagon House and your imagery, a beautiful plantation home, Octagon shape, started falling on hard times when the New Orleans took it over. You can see here, this is one of the last pictures with the porch remaining on the house itself. Though built of brick, and it's 4 brick thick, this Abijah Thomas had his enslaved people. They made so much brick. You had brick driveways, you had brick sidewalks. You had every amenity that you could think of with the house. So you can see in the second picture, this was after the porch was removed, and you can see the slow decline of the house itself. This is a picture of the house in the 1970s. Let me give you a little timeline of what happened. After several successive owners, an apple orchard bought the home in 1942. They used it as a barn, a storage facility for tobacco, apples, hay. I once asked my grandmother, when I took her back to the house when she was 91, I said, why didn't someone save the house then? And she gave me the best explanation ever. She lived there at the end of the Depression. She said, we finally had money. We could have different things. We could have new things. No one wanted the old things. And that didn't hit me until then. So that's why no one saved this house. So it went to an apple orchard that used it as storage. Excuse me. And sat there until 1976 when the apple orchard, which unfortunately was in a frost pocket, wasn't able to sustain that area, so they sold it off lot by lot. The house now sits on 2 acres, from 10,000 all the way down to 2 acres. But it's got a revival, and I'll tell you about that. The top left picture, that's actually after it was cleaned off. This house, you cannot see it from the road. It was wooded, it was covered in poison oak and Virginia creeper. I knew about the house because when I was growing up a teenager, I would go to the house and sit inside. I would make drawings, like I told Susan, but I was always fascinated with it as a child. Hearing the family story, my family connections to the house, that's something that's always been passionate to me, and that's why I went into architecture in the first place. But I had no idea that I would once again be involved with this house more than just something that I like to do or a passion. So one day I drove by and I saw a small sign at the road that said lot for sale. A week later, a large sign went up and said a historic home for sale. I went to the auction. Did not intend on purchasing the house. There were only about 10 or 12 people there. A lot of people that I talked to just wanted to tear it down. I said, no, there's no way we can let this piece of architecture be destroyed. So, according to our brother, I outbid him and took on this project. And I have to say it's been a labor of love, because, and I'll tell you where we're going with it. There's so much that I could tell you, but there's so much more in where we're going with it. So I bought the house. We cleared, hand cleared everything. We didn't want to destroy what might be there. And the picture you see on the right is where it is today. Now, I have to warn you, that's the front part of the house. In 1976, the man who purchased it started to restore it. He quit. Part of the roof peeled off a year or two later, and it sat for 30 years with the roof off in the back. So that caused a lot of damage to the structure of the house itself on the inside. The orchard actually had taken one wall out in the back, and they parked their trucks and their tractors in the family room. This house belies how large it is. Those windows on the bottom floor are 9 feet, 6 inches tall. This house is an immense brick home, 10 bedrooms. The table, the dining room table, set 24. Large, large home. This is a floor plan. If you haven't seen it, and I wanted to talk about Mr. Thomas, the way he thought about things. He had the iron foundry, but when he had this house built, and he designed the floor plans himself, he used the ancient technology of Morrison tenon construction, wood pegs, if you're not familiar with that. But he had the foresight to strengthen all those joints with iron straps. That's what's held this house up. Also, he had the foresight to think of heating and cooling ventilation. You know, before there were air conditioners and before there were central heating and air, you relied on fireplaces, stoves, and open windows. There are three things with this house. The first floor has a triangle foyer. Part of that is construction of the octagon, because you have the odd angles, the 45 degree angles, so you're limited in how you can build. But this is ingenious, because if the house is warm in the wintertime, you go in one door, you shut that door, you open another door and shut it, you don't let your heat out. So it's very ingenious. You had it both on the front and the back, which is more of a servant's entrance and exit. Cast iron fireplace inserts were actually built into the fireplaces when the house was built. That's a rarity. You know, a lot of times you'll see firebacks, or later into the Victorian age, you'll see the cast iron fireplace surrounds, those type things. These are heavy cast iron inserts. So long after the fire would go out, the house would stay, or have the heat radiated into the rooms. So you had a lot of thought. House has six fireplaces. Most every other room that doesn't have a fireplace had a place for a stove. At a time when a stove, in those days, would have cost a lot of money, very hard to transport, this house had 7 to 10 stoves. So you can look at the magnitude of the wealth and the access that the Thomas family had. I want to say this about the infamous dark room, if you've not heard of it. This is upstairs. There are lots of ghost stories and lots of paranormal stories about enslaved people being kept in the dark room, about whippings and those things. What we understand coming down through the family is that never occurred. And oh, and blood dripping down the walls. That never occurred. It was for storage. And then if one of the Thomas children needed some punishment, they would go into this room that has only a transom light above the door. So we don't discount anything that people say. So if you feel it, you feel it. That's what the dark room is, if you hear any stories about that. Let me tell you a little bit about the construction. One other ingenious plan that Mr. Thomas came up with, and if you look to the top right, the corner brick. Again, construction of an octagon, if you use brick, you're going to have an open space if you use a regular brick. This was a mold that he designed. The easiest way to say it is what you see on the outside is what you see on the inside. It looks like an old coffin shape. Not only does it cover up that area where weather could get into the brick, but also strengthens that corner. you'll see that the mortar joints are painted white. That was a status symbol for brick homes at the time. Not only was it brick and mortar, they painted every mortar joint. You can imagine how tedious that was. But with the affluency came those little details. The bottom left, you can see some of the construction, mortise and tenon with wood pegs. That's actually under the winter kitchen floor in the house. Top left, the house is four brick thick. It's interesting because it's an American bond house. I didn't know when I purchased the house that every fifth course of brick or fifth layer is an 8x8 brick. And that's what held your different widths of the wall together. You would have a Flemish bond and those type, but this is the American bond. So more prevalent up in the Shenandoah Valley, more rare down in Southwest Virginia. The other two pictures, that's inside the attic. And that's how you would support an octagon house roof. It's as, if you look there, it's like a spider web. But it's all wood pegged, all hand cut beams. And that took a lot of work, a lot of ingenuity and a lot of work. But that is still standing 150 years later. If you look to the bottom right, that is one of the iron straps. We didn't know that they were there until a piece of plaster fell off. But in every significant joint in the house, there's an iron strap. And that has helped strengthen the construction and has kept it up. The fireplace, it's kind of hard to see, but that is one of the cast iron built-in inserts that we have not seen in the other houses in Southwest Virginia. There is your foyer in the front. Now, I have to describe this foyer. When you walked in, it was double doors. You had beautiful murals, one above each door, and the trim work in that room was a pink faux marble. So once you entered, you, unless you were a special guest, you went right into the sitting room. If you were a special guest, you went left into the parlor that you'll see some pictures of in just a moment. That was reserved for special occasions and special guests. Another ingenuity trait that this house has, closets. The Octagon House had leftover spaces. And if you remember or know, a lot of times houses were taxed by closets and they were taxed by chimneys. This house had four chimneys, six fireplaces. It also had six closets. So we don't know if Smith County at the time actually took tax on that, but it wouldn't matter anyway. Budget included them, took out some of that leftover space, and this house had closets where most had a bureau or a wardrobe or those type of things. Now, the octagon shape is not what makes this house rare. It helps. But what you see here, there is on the bottom right, is one of the murals. Unfortunately, we don't have a color picture of that. That's all that we have. One of those murals. We have a description of the one above the other door. But those have been gone for many, many years. But what makes this house extremely rare, the Department of Historic Resources has said, the faux marbling that you see on the top right, when you walked or allowed into the parlor, it was as if you walked into an Italian or Grecian temple. It was blue and pink marble, faux blocks, covered the entire You can tell it's some of that early Victorian decoration, but this is typically reserved at that time for public buildings, courthouses, churches, those type of buildings. It was rare that you saw it in private homes, maybe in Savannah, Charleston, those areas, but here, especially in Southwest Virginia, to see that, that's what makes this rare, this house rare. To the left was the fresco on the ceiling. We don't have a color picture of it. What you see on the bottom left is all that's left. The house suffered for so many years from neglect that a lot of the plaster has fallen. So we've documented what we can. What you see on the top right, that's original, that's still there. So we will replace that. And not replace it, restore that, and then replicate what's left. The fresco in the ceiling was surrounded by different colored faux marble. There was a chandelier in this room in the parlor. I remember seeing a picture of it when the book, and there's a book floating around, was written in the 80s. It was a very unusual chandelier. It was brass, but it was covered in tiny leaves. As a child, I remember that. It's in a garage in Nashville. We know that. So we're going to try to get it back. Now, looking at these pictures, you have to understand, again, this house has been empty and neglected for over 80 years. So what you see on the floor is what you see on the floor. We don't want to take anything out. We don't want to move anything until we are ready to do that so that we can do it effectively and gently as possible. But what's important with these pictures, if you look on the top right, the decoration of this house did not stop with the parlor. Every room had a different color of marble baseboard, topped with a type of wood, or painted, or frescoes, those type of things. What you see on the top right is in the main stair hall upstairs. A black marble with a gold painting and faux mahogany. Even though it's scratched, it's still as beautiful as it was in 1860. Bottom right, bedroom, all original colors that you see. That's one bedroom with a black marble and a gold painting and that Williamsburg blue paint. Bottom left, some of the painting, this is Miss Thomas's bedroom. It was a cream colored marble with the beautiful flowers hand painted. That's the main staircase, which is kind of hidden. That was start of the trend where staircases weren't to be seen when you first walked in. It's actually a very dark space, but it's closer to the center of the house. But he did not stop with the decoration of it there. Every riser on that staircase is a different color marble. The staircase itself is surrounded by faux oak paneling. So everything that was in this house, from what we understand, was an itinerant French painter traveling through the area. He stayed there and painted this entire house with all the frescoes, all the murals, all the marble. Here's some of the wood graining, and I actually start with the one on the far right. That is some of the paneling that surrounds the staircase. That is still there. It's still as beautiful as it was. Yes, there are scratches, but it can be easily restored. The door in the middle, you can see that this is, you saw this a lot in plantation homes, was the faux graining. And the one on the left, that's actually different graining on the other side of the door that looks different. Mike Pulis, who's a friend of ours and a former board member, said this was the trend, but it's not what you think. It was mastery over nature. If you can create it, why use it? If you cannot import it, create it. So you saw the ingenuity and the Victorian thought coming out during this time. You can create it if you can't have it, and they did. This is what we're up against. The picture on the top left is the dining room. When I was a teenager, we'd go over, that floor was perfect. There was a leak, and now it's gone for the most part. We can restore it, that's not a problem, it's just what we're facing. Top right photo, when the apple orchard had the home, they cut that door out to park their trucks and things, like I said, in the family room. They didn't brace it well enough, the entire wall fell out. The cistern was to the right, near that pole. They filled the cistern up with the bricks from that wall. So we know where they are. They very hurriedly put up a concrete block wall. But above that is where the roof pulled back in the 70s and was not fixed until I purchased. So you have so much damage there. The middle picture is the parlor. That is the last remaining mantle. I remember all the other mantles in the bedrooms. There were different colors, yellow marble, green marble. And this one was unusual because it was a black marble, faux marble with white veining, but it was inlaid with glass to reflect the lamplight and the candlelight. So it was unusual. There's no glass left, but we still have the frame from it. Bottom left, you can see how perfect, actually, it still is. Look at the roof. 2009, we had a storm pull part of the roof off, and we've put that back. Still some damage, took the chimney tops off and those type of things. The bottom right picture, that was 30 years of water. And that was the connection between the family room and the winter kitchen. So, like Susan said, there's a lot of work to be done. But here we are. Now I will tell you, I did purchase the house in 2003. Susan reminded me a week ago, it's been 20 years. My idea was, and I was working on a bed and breakfast, and like a lot of people, 2008 hit me hard financially, so I didn't want this house to, didn't want it to fall. So what I did was created a foundation, and it's the Octagon House Foundation. We gave the house the land of the foundation, and we have been working since. Now honestly, initially it started out, let's just save this house, but it has grown into so much more. Yes, we have little fundraisers and those things that keeps us going, but it's the idea of where we're going to go that keeps people in these pictures coming back, and such as myself coming to speak. We do know the documented history of the Thomas family. We do know the trials, tribulations, the sadness, the relationships and those things. Because it is documented, or at least through word of mouth and then documented, we know those things. This is a community house. Like I said, this area would not be the same without the Octagon House. What we have developed and what we have come up with is this is going to be a type of cultural center. Yes, the house will be the way it was in 1860. Yes, the grounds, the area, all of that will be put back as best as we can, the documentation that we have. If not, at least something that's time period. This is often a subject that is controversial. It's also a subject that brings a lot of feelings and emotion to it, but that's what history does, and that's what history should. It used to be you could walk into a building or a house and you walk through velvet ropes and out the door and you may not have any more connections except that went there. Once this is up and going, this is our plan. Is to open this house to the public for many, many reasons. One, you have those who are interested in architecture. One, you have those who are interested in family life at that time, or war at that time. But there's so much more, and there were so many more people and so many more families that lived in this house and on this place than what is documented. Our plan is to show history for all people. The way that it was, the way that we see it now, we want to learn from the past, live what we have now, and then teach for the future. This home came out of a system and a society that was unjust to a lot of people, and particularly enslaved people, that we may have a name, we may not have a name. We want to give credit to that. We want to tell their stories. We want to make sure that they're able to have a name, to have some history. That's our goal, is to have this for everyone, everyone. So we've got a lot of people working. You can see there's a bunch of boys that worked in the brick. And we'll say about the brick, that house I showed you earlier to remember, that house had to be demolished because of structural issues, could not be saved. They donated the brick back to the Octagon House for us to use. It's time period. It was made in the same area, about 3 miles apart. So people are giving, and they're giving things that are unusual, which is great. Here it is. When I say now the rest of the story, we've talked a lot about the Thomas family, but again, there were so many more families and there were so many more people that were connected to this place. I want you to focus on that middle photograph. And if you can see it, there are three small fingerprints left in that brick. I didn't even notice that until I had second graders come and they had a tour around the house. And one of them went up to it and said, look, fingerprints. It was at that time you realized that that was a child slave. It was a child slave that turned and felt that brick before it was fired. That may be the only thing that we know of that human being. There's three fingerprints left. A friend of mine, his name's Benjamin Jackson. He's from Marion, but lives somewhere near Galax. This started him on a quest. He has now been to Monticello to show them fingerprints. He's been all over. And he said it started with the Octagon House, where I showed him these three fingerprints. That's what we want to do, is tell their story too. The lady on the right, the only thing we know is her name was Tilly. That's it. But she was photographed, and if we can find any connection, we want to tell her story. You have the ladies on the left. Yes, they're reenactors, but we have a lot of their story. We want to tell everyone's story so that they're given a voice. I can say they're because I don't know names. We are working with the Beyond Kin Project through Henry Henry College to help develop, find whatever we can of genealogy for the enslaved people at Mountain View Plantation. But there's so many connections, but there are also so many deficits when it comes to that. So when we're finished, we want people to come and experience that life, black or white, however it was, but leave knowing more or feeling more than when you walked in. You'll be able to see the plantation house itself, but you'll also be able to see back of the house where most guests and people would never be allowed to go. But that's where the real people worked hard to support this house. So we're going to recreate that. And everything that we do is going to tell a story, whether it's agricultural, whether it's social, educational. We want someone to come in and again leave feeling differently, thinking differently. We look at things through modern eyes, present day eyes. We didn't live that life. So we have to rely on artifacts, we have to rely on verbal stories, and we have to rely on written stories. We can assume lots of things, but just acknowledge what happened and who was there. Don't forget people just because of the way things have worked in the past. Give credence to everyone. So, I know that's condensed and it's short, but like I said, I could talk for hours. And feel free to ask me any questions, but thank you.
Question about the, what's the second floor like? The structure interiorly, like, can you walk up there or is it too dangerous?
There are spaces that I know where to walk. It is more intact than the first floor. There are, because there, with the water entering the house for several decades, it has caused some of those partitions to fall, not fall, but sink down. So the hallway upstairs, you walk and it dips. Luckily it stopped, and that's what we can put back. The first floor, we might be able to salvage 20% of that. Unfortunately, that's what happened over all those years. That is it's about an inch and a half thick, tongue and groove, hard pine floor. So we're going to save what we can and put it back. There's another plantation house that is actually to be demolished, unfortunately. So we're going to try to save and salvage from that. Well, we can. We want it to look exactly the way it was. Let me get into the microphone. The only thing we're going to change is heating, cooling, and electricity. That's it. You walk in as if you were walking in 1860. For that, I'm talking about the house. We don't want a place where you walk through velvet ropes, like I mentioned. We want it to be interactive. We want you to be able to sit on there. Obviously, we wouldn't have antique furniture to sit on, but we want you to experience that. So, history is more experiential now, from in the house to what they're doing in the kitchens out back. People want to be involved. And our plan is to even have brick making on site, like Williamsburg has. So, to be involved in it, that's said a lot.
Any other questions?
Yes.
I have a couple questions. Was there any indoor plumbing or anything?
No. The house, around that time is when bathrooms started to become, especially for the wealthy, be placed in homes. But this house did not have that. Susan and I talked, I wish I knew where the outhouses were, because they are a wealth of information to what happened on that place. And it happened in other places too. You would throw your trash or things into the outhouse just to get rid of it. Or, like the trap door that's in the winter kitchen for this house, you just open it up, throw it under the house. So those areas they're very important for archaeological information. The house was never modernized. It was never repainted. So every color paint is original. There was never electricity. Even though when it was a barn, actually maybe one of his apartments, they ran a line across the ceiling, but that was it. So, which is good because they didn't destroy what's there.
Is there any graveyard associated?
There is, and it's interesting. Before you get to the house, it's not even a quarter mile, maybe eighth of a mile, if that, is the Thomas family cemetery. And it started as a family because that was the Thomas original home place. It's now grown. It's not a large cemetery, but I don't know, 200 maybe grave markers. When the house was built, it was a large wrought iron fence. It actually went down the plantation road, which comes up beside the Octagon House, goes out Thomas Bridge Road, and that's for the Thomas family. They went all the way to the cemetery. Large, tall, not what you'd see around some Victorian homes. That was actually melted down in all the way to the cemetery. Now, some of the ghost stories say that December 1st, when Bijan Thomas died, that there's a blue light that shines from the cemetery to the house. I've never seen it. Now, you couldn't see it because the woods have grown up between them. We do also know that there's a slave cemetery. We don't know the exact location, but it's both plots, slave cemetery itself and the Thomas family cemetery, they're covered in thick layers of concrete. Some people have said it was because the graves fell in. You know, the caskets really didn't last that long. And the smell was bad. People robbed graves. They really did. So you find a wealthy family, and there's no telling what would be dug up. It's interesting, one of their daughters was one of the first buried in the cemetery. She was married in the house. They had the double parlor in the sitting room open. She was married in the house, I think it was the spring, 1863. She went with her husband, her name was Eliza Bramlett, to Macon, Georgia. During Sherman's march is when she died. It was brought back at her funeral. I think it was in the fall. Within 9 months, she was buried and then died. So she was one of the first buried. She's buried beside Mr. and Ms. Thomas. That's one of those little stories that we can talk forever.
any other comment questions?
Yes.
Did the porch go originally all around the house? And it looks a little different in your drawing on the left there than the picture, so.
The original porch was the front three sides, front and then your adjacent sides. That picture, actually, Historic American Building Survey, Library of Congress, and the 1953. They completed a study on the house. So if you go on HABS, H-A-B-S, Library of Congress, the Bijan Thomas house is there. And it gives us a lot of detail for the house itself when we restore it back for the use. So that was an architectural drawing. I don't think they were aware of the front. fenestration and the gingerbread work, early gingerbread work of that porch. Some people say that porch is not original, but it really goes along with that time period. It was the early Victorian. You notice the picture that a local artist had painted. There were brick columns. Now, in the book, and there are several books over here on the left and some artifacts that are probably found around the house. It showed, or it says, that the porch was brick columns. That was wood in those pictures. And there hasn't been any evidence found that those were brick columns. It also said that they would pull the carriages up and park them on the porch. That wasn't done. That wasn't done. You would never have done that. So the porch itself, it actually extended out some in the front, and that's where you had the brick driveway come up and go around. What I found after I bought the house, and I was really just trying to save an old plant out back in the woods, and planted it in front of the house, was I put my shovel on the ground and it went down maybe 2 inches and quit. Strange, so I went a few more feet, did the same thing. So I just dug down one of the last brick sidewalks that are left, because in the 1930s the owners took early tractors, we don't know why, and they dug up the sidewalks, they dug up the driveway. They might have used them somewhere else, we just don't know. But I found the sidewalk that they did not dig up. And it actually went from the porch out to the plantation road, and I learned later that there were large gates, iron gates and brick pillars, and that's where if you weren't brought up the front porch, you could get off there and walk to the porch. But that sidewalk is amazing. What's part of his brick manufacturer was a salt glaze brick. Do you know what a salt glaze brick looks like? It's actually very dangerous to make and it's expensive. You throw salt on it when it's hot. That sidewalk is interspersed with glazed brick, so in the moonlight or the sunlight, it would shine. There was a large patio out back of the house that the family would sit at in the summer, and the house shaded the back. It was a large patio, and that was interspersed with a salt glaze brick. We have one row of brick left that they didn't get too close to the house, but it's there. So it's amazing. You really should come to Marion, come out of the house. You're welcome to go anytime. We have a kiosk up front that you saw in our pictures. Feel free to walk around the house. I would love to take you inside, but our insurance said no way. We don't want you to fall through the floor. So our plan is once we make it structurally stable, floors in place, we're going to open it so that you can go through while the restoration is going on. Our largest problem at this point was not raising the money, it's finding people to work. We can't get anybody to do it. Last contractor we actually talked to said, I can start in 2.5 years. We can't wait. So send people our way if you know. Yes.
Is that, you know, is specific, I assume these are people who are versed in laying these like particular styles of flooring that were done at the time of the restoration. Like, do you have to comply with historical preservation standards?
Yes.
When you're doing this?
We are actually under the National Park Service, their guidelines. Our architect has, he's wonderful. That's what his forte is architectural, or historical architecture. He's completed many buildings himself. So he's come up with a wonderful plan that's been approved by the National Park Service Department of the Interior. You know, we have to use everything that's there, and we have to replicate it, but then we have to say that's replicated. Yes, I would love to do like poplar forest and have those construction techniques, but that would take generations. So, but yeah, it'll look exactly the way it was.
We're coming up at a quarter past the hour, so what I want to do is direct you to your brochure. The foundation can be reached through a website as well as
yes.
A Facebook page, and there are opportunities for giving and helping in their effort. And to reach out to Derek and find a time to go pull him off of his other duties as assigned and go walk,
yes.
Walk the field. Derek, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I really appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Good. We will see.